मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट, आई किशोर सिंह चौहान वेलकम यू ऑल इन सोशल साइंस क्लास। इन टूडेज सोशल साइंस क्लास आई एम गोइंग टू टीच यू द सेकेंड चैप्टर फ्रॉम ज्योग्राफी स्ट्रीम ऑफ क्लास 9th एंड द टाइटल ऑफ दिस चैप्टर इज फिजिकल फीचर्स ऑफ इंडिया। स्टूडेंट, बिफोर वी प्रोसीड द चैप्टर आई एम गोइंग टू टेल यू दैट व्हाट आर द सब टॉपिक्स दैट वी विल डिस्कस in this chapter. So first we will start with introduction, then we will discuss all the major physical features of India in detail, and then we conclude this chapter by understanding and by explaining that how all these physical features of India important to all of us. So let's begin this chapter. Dear student, we have already read in the previous chapter that area-wise, India is the 7th largest nation in the world. And if we talk about physical features of the earth, so in our nation, practically we have all major physical features of the earth. That is mountains, plains, deserts, plateaus and islands. So we are going to learn more about all these physical features of our nation as well as that how they have been formed. So before we continue discuss in detail about all these physical features, let's begin with the group in which group these physical features are divided or given. You have already read in your previous classes that the physical features of India group under the following future geographic division, and these are the Himalaya mountains, the northern plains, the peninsular plateau, the Indian desert, the coastal plains and the island. So I'm going to start with the very first and important physical feature, and that is Himalaya mountain. Before this, here I am going to suggest you that whenever you learn these physical features of India, learn with the help of map, so you can get the exact location of these physical features in our nation. So I am going to share the map. In this map you can see that I have circled with different color all the 6 important physiogeographic division of India. Okay, with green color you can see I have highlighted the Himalaya mountains, then with yellow color the Indian desert, okay, then with orange color the northern plain, with white color the peninsular plateau part, with purple color both group of islands, okay, and with blue color this is coastal plain. So all these physical division of India. So whenever you learn and read, learn with the help of map to get the exact location. So let's start with the very first, and that is the Himalaya mountains. Student, the Himalaya, if you talk about features, so the Himalayas are geologically young and structurally fold mountains. Means in which category they come? They come in the category of fold mountains, and they stretch over the northern border of India. If we talk about the ranges, okay, river wise, so these mountain ranges run in a west east direction, from west to east direction, from Indus to Brahmaputra river. The Himalaya, which represent the loftiest, okay, which is one of the loftiest and one of the most rugged mountains barriers of the world. Barrier means as an obstacle. It help us or our nation to protect from the cold winds from Central Asia as well as from the our enemy neighboring nation also. So these are the, you can say, rugged mountain barriers of the world. If you talk the site, so these mountains cover a distance of 2400 kilometers. If we talk about their width, So average width is 400 kilometer. This is in Kashmir, and this width reduced in eastern part of our nation, and it is 150 kilometer in Arunachal Pradesh. And if you look in map, this Himalaya mountain is an arc shape. In which shape it is? It is in arc shape. Now Himalaya mountain, this consists of three parallel ranges. How many ranges? Three parallel ranges. Now we are going to discuss the very first parallel range, that is the Himadri, Great or Hinner Himalayas. Okay, it is the most continuous range. First of all, this is continuous range of the loftiest peaks. Loftiest means tallest. Most of the tallest peaks are situated here, and the average height of all these tallest peaks are 6000 meters. And second important thing, that it contains almost, as I told you, all the tallest mountain peaks, okay, of the Himalaya region. Now if we talk about the core part of this Himalaya, so the core of this part of Himalaya is completely composed of granite, and it is perennially snowbound, means most of the peaks of this Himalaya mountain is completely covered with snow. And a number of glaciers which present in this range, and from this glacier we get number of rivers, especially the northern part of our nation. Now we are going to discuss the second important mountain range of the Himalaya, and that is called as Himachal or Lesser Himalaya. Okay, so here I'm again suggesting you that when you study these three ranges of Himalaya, try to learn by comparison with them. So how you will compare? Look, we have discussed right now about Himadri. Now we are going to discuss about Lesser or Himachal. Okay, the ranges are mainly composed of highly compressed and altered rocks, where Himadri composed of granite. Okay, second thing, the altitude varies. In Himadri, average 6000 meters. So here the altitude varies between 3700 to 4500 meters. And if you talk about width, so width in Himadri from 400 to 150 kilometer. Here the width average is 50 kilometer, where Himadri having almost all the loftiest peaks of the Himalaya. Here Pir Panjal, okay, which is one of the longest and most important range, as well as Dholadhar and Mahabharat range, these are the prominent which are situated in Lesser Himalaya or Himachal. Now another feature, if we talk, then this range consists of number of famous valleys of Kashmir, like the Kangra, the Kullu Valley in Himachal Pradesh. And this region is very popular for its different hill station. A number of people, okay, mostly visit this hill station in summer. Now we are going to discuss the next, and that is the Shivalik. The Shivalik is the outermost range of the Himalaya. This is the outermost range of the Himalaya, and width wise it is 10 to 50 kilometer, and altitude also varies, and the altitude average is between 900 to 1100 meters. Now composition of this range, so these ranges are composed of unconsolidated sediments, and these sediment brought by rivers, okay, which originate from the Himadri glaciers. And these valleys are covered with thick gravel and alluvium soil, which is one of the most fertile soil available in our nation. Now the longitudinal valley lying between Lesser Himalaya, which is also called Himachal, and the Shivalik, which is the last range of the Himalaya, are known as dunes. Okay, you have heard the famous dunes like Dehradun, Kotli Dune, partly dune. Okay, and these are the very famous dunes which are situated here. Now we have discussed that longitudinal division. Now we are going to discuss the division of Himalaya on the basis of regions, area, and this area started from west to east. So let's start with the very first. Okay, the path of Himalaya lying between Indus and Satluj. Which river? Indus and Satluj has been traditionally known as Punjab Himalaya, and these are also known as Kashmir or Himachal. Okay, so the area between Indus and Satluj. The second part of this same Himalaya range, which lying between Satluj and Kali River, is called or famous as Kumaon Himalaya. And the third range, which lying between Tista and Dihang River, Tista and Dihang River, is called Assam Himalaya. Now the last end point of this Himalaya range, okay, which situated in northeastern state, and where we have this Brahmaputra River also, and we know that this Brahmaputra marks the easternmost boundary of the Himalayas. Beyond Dihang Gorge, the Himalaya bend sharply to the south and spread along the eastern boundary of our nation India, and this path is known as Purvanchal or the eastern hills and mountains. So this is all about the first physiogeographic division of India. Now we are going to discuss the second physiogeographic division of India, and that is the Northern Plains. Student, the Northern Plain has been formed by the interplay of three major river systems. Okay, and these river systems are the Indus, the Ganga, and the Brahmaputra, along with their tributaries. Tributaries, you know very well, these are the small rivers or streams which join the main river. Okay, so this complete Northern Plain is formed by these three river system and this and their tributaries. This plain is formed mostly of alluvial soil, which is the most important soil, fertile soil of our nation. Okay, if you talk about the total stretch area under this plain area, so that the plain being about 2400 kilometer long, just equal to the Himalaya mountain range. Okay, and if we talk about the width, so width is varies from 240 to 320 kilometer, and this complete Northern Plain, comparatively of other physical division of our nation, highly populated, and reasons are very simple. Here we have large number of rivers, these rivers are perennial, then soil is fertile because of alluvial soil, plain area, okay, climate is suitable. So this area is completely highly populated in comparison of other part. So the rivers of Northern Plains coming from the mountains, Northern Mountains, are involved in depositional work, especially in which course, in the lower course, and due to the gentle slope, the velocity of the river decreases, speed decreases, which result in the formation of number of riverine islands. And for your information, Majuli in the Brahmaputra River, okay, is the largest inhabited riverine island in the world. So these rivers which are present in Northern Plain also form riverine island. Now we are going to discuss about the rivers and their lower course. Okay, so the rivers in their lower course, they split into numerous channels, means they divide it into again different channels. Due to the reason is again what? Due to the deposition of silt soil, and these channels are known as distributaries. We discussed about tributaries, and these are distributaries. Now if we talk about the division of Northern Plain, so the Northern Plain is broadly divided into three sections. How many sections? Three sections. The western part of the Northern Plain is referred to as the Punjab Plains, which is formed by river Indus and its tributaries, okay, and other rivers like the Jhelum, the Chenab, Ravi, Bias, and Satluj. Okay, So this is the first division of northern plain. Then the second division that extend between the Ghaggar and Tista river, and it spread over the states like North India, Haryana, Delhi, UP, Bihar, and the last part which is situated in northeastern state, okay, and it is completely made by the Brahmaputra river. If we talk about this another feature of this northern plain, so the largest part of northern plain is formed of older alluvium. Which soil? Older alluvium soil. So this is all about the now student. We are going to discuss the next feature, geographic division of India, and that is peninsular plateau. Now what is peninsula? Peninsula, if you look the shape of India, especially from Gujarat to West Bengal and at Kanyakumari, or you can say Tamil Nadu, so you will find that India is surrounded by three side waters. In east side we have Bay of Bengal, in west side we have Arabian Sea, and at south we have Indian Ocean. So the area or large piece of land which is surrounded by three side water is called peninsula. So the shape of India is peninsula, that's why it is called the peninsular plateau. Now what is plateau? Plateau is large high area of flat land, of flat land comparison with hills and mountains. So that is plateau. So this is the third important physiogeographic division of India, the peninsular plateau, which is a table land. It is completely composed of old crystalline igneous and metamorphic rocks. Three rocks: crystalline, igneous and metamorphic rock. And this was formed due to the breaking and drifting of Gondwana land. This Gondwana land, which was earlier part of the ancient continent Pangaea, this was the southern part, okay. And age wise if we look, so this is the very oldest landmass situated in our nation. Now this plateau consists of two broad divisions. First, the central highland, and second, the Deccan plateau. The part of the peninsular plateau which lie to the north of the Narmada river and up to the Malwa plateau is completely called central highland. The central highland feature wise wider in the west direction and narrow in the east direction. The eastward extension of this plateau are locally famous as Bundelkhand and Bagelkhand. Two name, Bundelkhand and Bagelkhand. The Chota Nagpur plateau marks or make the further eastward extension, which is drained by the one of the very famous river of this plateau region, and that is Damodar river. Now we are going to discuss about the second, that is the Deccan plateau. Student, if you look the map of our nation, okay, which I shared you, so you will find that this Deccan plateau is a triangular landmass that lies to the south of river Narmada. This is triangular in shape, okay, which I have highlighted with white color. So this is Deccan plateau, and this is completely in triangular shape of landmass. So this Deccan plateau is higher in altitude in the west and having gentle slopes in the eastward direction. Now we are going to discuss by comparison between two important part, okay, which marks the western and eastern edges of Deccan plateau, and these are the Western Ghats and the Eastern Ghats. So first of all, Western Ghats obviously lie parallel to the western coasts, and they are continuous and can be crossed through passes only. Western Ghats are higher in comparison of the Eastern Ghats, and the average elevation is in Western Ghat is 900 to 1600 meter, in Eastern Ghat where it is 600 meter, okay. Now if we talk about the highest peak, of eastern and western ghats. So in western ghat, the highest peak is Anaimudi and the height is 2695 meter. Where in eastern ghat, the highest peak is Mahendragiri, okay, and the height is 1501 meter. So this is all about the peninsular plateau. Now we are going to discuss the next physiographic division of our nation, and that is the Indian desert or the Thar desert. Now the location. The Indian desert lies towards the western margins of the Aravali Hills. These Aravali Hills which divide Rajasthan almost into two parts, eastern and western. So this is completely lies in the western part of Aravali, like Jaisalmer, Barmer, okay, Bikaner. So these are the districts. Now if we talk about other features, so this complete area covered with, or you can say complete area is sandy plain covered with sand dunes. Now what are sand dunes? Sand dune means these are the small hills made up of sand, okay, and this region which receive very low rainfall in comparison of other part of our nation, and it is almost 150 millimeter per year, which is very very low. And because of this low rainfall, it has arid climate with low vegetation cover. And if you talk about the streams, so stream appears but only during the rainy season, okay, and after rainy season soon they disappear into the sand. So there is shortage of water. And if you talk about river, so Luni is the only large river in this region. Now the next feature of this area, that is Barchan, which is a tourist attraction also. Barchan means these are the crescent shaped sand dunes. These are crescent shaped sand dunes, and these cover large area, okay, and they are mainly attraction of tourists in this part. Now we are going to discuss the next, and that is the coastal region. Student, the peninsular plateau, right now we have discussed, is flanked by stretch or narrow coastal strips, okay, running along the Arabian Sea in the west, and in east we have Bay of Bengal. Now we are going to discuss first western part. The western coast, it's like a sandwich between western ghats and the Arabian Sea. Arabian Sea and western ghats. So this long narrow strip, it consists of three sections, divisions. The northern part of this coast is called Konkan, from Mumbai to Goa, Konkan coast. And the central stretch is called Kannad Plain. And the last, which is situated in the southern, is called Malabar coast. So this is all about the western coastal plain. Now we are going to discuss the eastern coastal plain. The plain along the Bay of Bengal are wide and level in comparison of the coastal plain situated in western part. In the northern part, it referred as the northern circle, okay, while the southern part is known as Coromandel coast. Here we have large number of rivers like Mahanadi, okay, on which the Hirakud dam is situated, then Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri, and all these rivers before their final destination, means before fall in Bay of Bengal, they form large number of deltas. So this eastern part is also well known for large number of deltas. Here we have Lake Chilka also, which is also important lake with important features situated on eastern coastal plain. Now we are going to discuss the last physiographic division of India, and that is group of island. Look, India is having two group of islands on both directions, first in the eastward and second in the westward. In eastward, this group of island is called the Andaman and Nicobar. The northern part is called Andaman and southern part is called Nicobar, and the capital of this group of island is Port Blair. Okay, in Port Blair we have very famous and historical the cellular jail, which has historical importance. Okay, this group of island has great strategic importance for our nation also. Here we have great diversity of flora and fauna, okay, and here we have evergreen types of forest also. Now the group of island which is situated in Arabian Sea, and this group of island is called Lakshadweep, and the capital of this group of island is Kavrethi. This group of island is also having great diversity of flora and fauna, but the one unique feature which make different from Andaman and Nicobar Island, and that is this island is completely called coral island. It is made up of beautiful coral, so this attract large number of tourists to this island, and every year number of tourists come and visit to see the beauty of this island. Now we are going to conclude this chapter by discussing the importance of all these six physiogeographic division for our nation. Student, a detailed account of different physiogeographic which right now we discussed highlights the unique feature of each region. Like we discussed the Himalaya, Northern Plain, Desert, Coastal Plains, then the Peninsular Plateau. So all of them has unique feature. Okay, so it also be clear that each region, each area complement the other and makes the country richer in the natural resources. How? The Northern Mountain are the major sources of water and forest fuel, which is also important for economic and other development. Okay, now the Northern Plain are the granaries of country. How they are granaries? Because here we have perennial river, here we have plain area, fertile soil, so they as an granary for our nation, they provide, you can say, base for early civilization. In history, if you read, you will find that large number of civilization flourished in this area only. Now the plateau, which is a storehouse of mineral, okay, and which has played a crucial role in the industrialization and economic development of our nation, because all the important minerals are situated there, and without them we can't think of any economic and any development. Now if we talk about the coastal region and the island group of island Andaman and Lakshadweep, so they provide sites for fishing and port activities. Okay, India are very well connected for international trade and other activity by the ports and harbors situated in this coastal area. Okay, so we can say that the diverse physical features of the lands have immense future possibility of development, and these all are complement with each other, and they really play very very important and vital role in the overall development of our nation. So this is all about this chapter. Thank you.